Now that we live in a post-apocalyptic hellscape where GPUs are traded for things like food and water, we've decided to take a look at Intel's IGPs. It's been a little while, but the integrated graphics processors in Intel CPUs potentially offer a unique advantage in a market where GPUs are difficult to find, or at least overpriced. And AMD, it has APUs. They're in the 3000 series right now. Presumably 5000 series APUs will be coming to desktop with newer architecture sometime in the near future. But we haven't looked at any form of integrated graphics processor for quite a while at this point. And so we're going to look at the IGPs specifically to try and determine two things. One, we think that there has to be a reason that Intel launched the 11900 and 11700K. And maybe it's hidden in the IGP. We haven't tested that yet. Maybe that's where it is. And it is upgraded, by the way, over the 10 series. And then two, this is probably the one time where an IGP in a high-end CPU that's destined for gaming might actually prove useful as a stopgap measure, aside from the usual troubleshooting advantages or Intel QuickSync advantages that are offered in some unique scenarios. So let's get into the benchmarks. We'll be talking about the IGPs on the 11 and the 10 series today versus some low-end discrete GPUs. Before that, this video is brought to you by EVGA's new keyboards. EVGA's new Z20 and Z15 RGB optical mechanical gaming keyboards have abundant RGB LEDs and programmable macro keys on the left side of the keyboard. They also have a sensor to detect and turn on the LEDs when you're in front of the keyboard and turn them off when distant, offering a unique feature for keyboards. The keyboard claims a 0.5 millisecond response time and 100 million keystroke lifespan. Learn more at the link in the description below. So there are some tasks where Intel's integrated graphics are distinctly useful, even if you have a desktop GPU, a discrete GPU or dGPU. And one of those would be, in the past, things like Adobe Premiere, where Intel QuickSync actually does genuinely accelerate some of the tasks that are done in Premiere. Beyond that, an integrated graphics option is useful for mostly troubleshooting. So if you're trying to figure out if the system is failing to boot because your video card you purchased was dead on arrival, or it was used and maybe it's dead or whatever, you can pull it out, boot with the onboard video, and that might be a way to quickly draw a conclusion as to what the problem is. Aside from these things, for a gaming-focused system, meaning something that's more than just deployment in an office situation or a school situation, it's very likely that the high-end Intel CPUs especially will be paired with a dedicated GPU in a PCIe slot, and so the IGPs mostly go unused, thus the arrival of the F-SKU Intel CPUs. You might have seen the 10900KF, for example. We're waiting for the C model to come out after that, but the KF model does in fact drop the IGP, which to help a little bit with cost for people who are only ever going to use it with a dGPU. Intel's new socketed 11 series CPUs come with either UHD Graphics 730 or UHD Graphics 750. The UHD 750 ships with processor SKUs from the i5-11500 up to the i9-11900K. The i5-11600K falls in this range, and that's what we'll be using today for testing against some of the older UHD Graphics 630 CPUs, in the form of the i9-10900K in this instance, and we'll also be testing against a cheap dGPU as another stopgap alternative. Buying another dGPU like a GT1030 does add cost. So this is one where, sure, it's nice to use the word stopgap and say it's just filler until you can get the GPU you want, but you're still spending extra money on it. Whereas the appeal of an IGP is that you get something you can maybe at least play something like Rocket League or CSGO or something on until you can get the GPU that you actually want. The difference, though, is that if something like a GT1030, GDDR5 version, mind you, is acceptable to you for the near term, then perhaps combining that with an AMD CPU, if it's a cheaper option, depending on where you are, maybe that makes more sense than buying an Intel CPU just to get the IGP. In other words, is there a reason aside from the integrated graphics processor to buy the Intel CPU for you? And if the reason is no, and that would include money, so cheaper or not cheaper, if the reason's no, then maybe the AMD option plus a GT1030 makes more sense. If the reason's yes, maybe this makes more sense. So that's what we're gonna be looking through. Let's talk about how these CPUs and IGPs are set up. The UHD 750 is part of Intel's new Xe graphics family. But because the UHD 750 is part of Rocket Lake desktop parts, it's 14 nanometers plus 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 and not 10 nanometers. G4 and G7 graphics included in the new Intel Tiger Lake processors found in laptops are 10 nanometers and have considerably higher specs. The UHD 750 contains 32 EUs, or execution units, while the Tiger Lake Pentium Gold 7505 has 48 EUs, according to Intel's own database. We can't make valid comparisons until we do testing on 10 nanometer Xe graphics, but the UHD 730 and 750 IGPs are the lowest tiers of this generation of Intel graphics. Maximum supported resolution is 5120 by 3200 at 60 Hz via DisplayPort. This is an important consideration as many of the boards intended for gaming have limited onboard options for display output. For example, our CPU bench, which uses a high-end Asus Maximus board, has only a single HDMI port. Our other test subject today is the UHD Graphics 630, which is basically the same as HD Graphics 630, an IGP that was introduced back in 2017 with such CPUs as the 7700K. It was also shipped with SKUs as low-end as the Pentium G4600. Despite the name update from HD to UHD, the 10900K's IGP doesn't support any higher resolutions than the one included in the 7700K did. In the 10900K, the IGP has a base clock of 350 MHz and a boost of 1.2 GHz. With both the UHD 630 and the UHD 750, maximum graphics memory is listed as 64 GB, because by default, the IGP can share up to half of the system's memory, and the maximum amount of system memory supported by both CPUs and their platforms is 128 GB. An amount of dedicated, rather than shared, graphics memory can be specified in BIOS, but we found in early and brief testing that increasing this value did not have a significant impact on our results that we're presenting today. Testing for today will be focused on 1080p gaming. You can drop below this, obviously, for IGPUs, but we have a certain floor that we're willing to stop at and not really willing to go much below for testing within a reasonable use case. And 1080p is about where it stops for us. Not willing to go below that. Even still, at 1080p, we're mostly GPU bottlenecked here, especially in instances with an IGP use, but also in instances with a GT 1030 in a lot of cases. For the GT 1030, we're using the GDDR5 variant primarily. There are a couple of charts with the DDR4 variant in there. A couple years ago when that came out, we remarked on what a fiasco it was and how terribly misleading it was that NVIDIA would release two cards with the same name and a couple of letters appended to the end, which most users, especially buyers of a 1030, will never notice and certainly won't know the significance of. But there's a massive difference between the D4 and the G5 versions of the 1030, so keep that in mind. Do not buy the DDR4 version. It's garbage, and it should have been discontinued. Or renamed in a more hefty fashion, like GT 1020 or something like that. So buggy drivers then, the main thing, there is technically a software package with the Intel driver suite for the IGPs. But first of all, on launch day for the Intel 11 series, that was the day we decided, you know, let's look at these IGPs. We don't really normally look at them. We just focus on the CPU performance. Let's add that in there and see how they are. Lo and behold, on that day that this box of CPUs came out to the public, we checked Intel's official websites, we checked the motherboard manufacturer official websites, and the updated graphics processor drivers were nowhere to be found. We did have them, but it was through press access, which isn't public, and therefore is ridiculous as the only mode of access when a processor goes public. That's insane. So it was a really fumbled launch in a very strange way by Intel for one of the only obvious upgrade paths from the 10 series, because certainly the core count was not upgraded, and certainly performance wasn't really upgraded. So you're left with an IGP advantage in the 11 versus 10 series, which you can't even get an updated driver for. It should be out there by now. We haven't followed up. We used the press version, but that was a major fumble. It's an organizational thing, though. Hopefully this is something that Intel can work past. There were still driver bugs, though, and one of them is it seems like there's some sort of VSync issue where, especially with Intel's software installed, we have some difficulty toggling off VSync in certain games when you can set the setting in the game and attempt to override or use the game for the primary settings, and VSync might still be stuck, enabled. So that's a little problematic for testing, and if you're not a fan of VSync, then it's problematic for you as well. It wasn't in all of them, but a couple. The software package also didn't always seem to work for toggling VSync off, but part of that is because to get the IGP software bundle outside of just the drivers, you did have to use an older version of the driver package up until the updated drivers got released publicly for the 11 series. So that was another separate issue. The UHD 750 and 630 have relatively few display modes available, which means that when the bug appears for VSync, it limits frame rates to 60 FPS at many resolutions, even on displays which are capable of higher refresh rates. To start, we ran the GTA benchmark at the same settings that we normally use for CPU benchmarking, purely for reference. This isn't reasonable for an IGP, and we wouldn't suggest that you run a game at this graphics level on an integrated GPU, but the objective was to use one benchmark that was comparable like for like with our normal bench to establish a baseline for our expectations. It's been a little while since we've worked on an IGP, so this helps lay the groundwork. When paired with an RTX 3080, the 11600K averaged 133 FPS in the same test, and the 10900K averaged 130 FPS. Using the IGP of either CPU to run the game at these settings made it look like a slideshow, and it ran in the range of 8 to 16 FPS average between the two of them. That doesn't mean you can't play GTA 5, just that these settings are too much, obviously, for these IGPs. But we'll cut that down in a moment to lower settings. A 1050 Ti was the minimum requirement to get about 60 FPS at 1080p with the very high and ultra settings that we normally use, just for baseline, and the UHD 750 ended up 82% ahead of the UHD 630, while the GDDR5 version of the GT 1030 offered approximately twice the performance in terms of average frame rate of the UHD 750, or 245% more than the UHD 630. For the rest of our games, we tuned the settings down to get approximately 60 FPS baseline on the UHD 750, and then we structured the benchmarks around that, and obviously that's as paired with the 11600K or the 10900K for the 630 for our other testing. Counter-Strike was the first of our tests where we aimed for a playable frame rate on the newer IGP. Settings were manually adjusted to medium with texture streaming disabled. These settings were applied to all configurations under test. The average was 60 FPS, VSync off for that, on the UHD 750, and it was unchanged by higher speed memory. That doesn't mean memory doesn't affect the result. It should, because that's how an IGP works. It doesn't have its own memory. But it does mean that our selection of memory and this particular game didn't show an impact. The UHD 750 showed a 31% improvement over the older UHD 630's average of 46 FPS, but the 1% and 0.1% lows were abysmal when compared to the dGPUs. The best we saw was 21 FPS average in the UHD 750 for 1% lows, or 18 for the 630. Despite an average frame rate of approximately 60 FPS here, which is really fine for these games, the actual real-world gameplay is almost sickening. Gameplay is riddled with micro stutters, and it's nauseating for frame time pacing, especially on the 10900K. We played a round of Arms Race, formerly Gun Game, for those of you who remember it from Source, and found that even just transitioning between doorways could result in a severe and sudden stutter. This materializes in the 1% and 0.1% lows to some extent, but it's more obvious in a frame time plot, which we'll look at in a moment. The GT 1030 with G5 memory outstrips the 11600K's integrated GPU by 75% here, but more importantly, it maintained an actually playable frame time pacing. The GT 1030 isn't what we'd call good, but it offers a meaningfully improved experience. We're not just talking frame rate snob territory here either. The frame time pacing was legitimately bad enough on the 10900K especially to feel nauseating at these settings in higher paced gameplay. You could drop down in quality further to help things along, but no settings change will rectify the wide gulf between the average and the frame time spikes as compared to something like a cheap dGPU. Here's where it becomes obvious what the problem is. With the 10900K and its IGP, our frame times are all over the place. They bounce between as low as 3 milliseconds, which is impressive on its own, up to over 40 milliseconds, with some spikes over 60 milliseconds, although infrequent. The fact that this bounces around so violently speaks strongly against the viability of this particular configuration for a good experience with our CSGO settings, and they aren't that abusive for graphic settings. Here's the frame time plot for the 11600K with its IGP. It's much better than before, but we have a cyclic pulse in the range of 40 to 50 milliseconds, and then back down to the sub 10 millisecond range. That's not as nauseating as the 10900K's performance with its IGP, but it's still just objectively worse than even a cheap dGPU. This plot of the GT 1030's frame times is more like how it should look. We even adjusted the scale down to 20 milliseconds on the left axis to better accommodate the fact that it doesn't need the entire 0 to 80 millisecond range that we needed a moment ago, and it's an eye-opener to see how much even a cheap dGPU like the 1030, which we don't particularly strongly recommend in any circumstance, but even a cheap one like this is providing a meaningfully better experience. You can feel the difference in gameplay between the two devices. This is more than just demanding those high frame rate numbers, it actually is just genuinely more playable. But there's one downside. You lose the excuse when you die that it was stuttering or lag. Fortnite does have a replay system that should theoretically make testing easy, but we switched between replays, the battle lab, and actual gameplay to get a full picture of how the game performs. Replays can be problematic because they're only compatible with the version of the game that they were recorded in, and Fortnite updates frequently, so they break frequently. We therefore used battle lab for baseline testing that you're going to see in this chart for single player, which means that these FPS numbers are higher than they would be during normal gameplay. We saw an average of around 34 to 35 FPS, for example, with the UHD 750 in combat online, compared to 49 FPS in the averages shown in the battle lab. Scaling between the GPUs is the same using this testing as it would be during normal gameplay, though, so it's useful for relative or non-absolute performance comparison. The UHD 750 outperformed the older UHD 630 by 49%, an impressive uplift, but not enough to hit 60 FPS, even at these minimal settings, and uncharacteristically easy workload for the game. Meanwhile, the GT 1030 averaged 93 FPS when paired with either CPU, which gives it enough headroom to maintain a steady 60 FPS average during firefights. The IGPs aren't bad for a stopgap, and it is usable, but the type of game will obviously dictate the usefulness. Here it worked out okay. We played Fortnite in a real match on the 10900K IGP and found that, overall, it was playable and far better than in CSGO, without any particularly bad stutters during the time that we played it. So we'd call this acceptable, and it does work as a good stopgap if you're waiting for another GPU. You don't necessarily need to waste money on a 1030 if it would have no further use beyond waiting for the one you really want to come in stock. Fortnite also has a performance mode, currently in alpha, that reduces settings even beyond the lowest settings available in the DX11 graphics menu. Scaling between the IGPs is almost precisely identical here, with the 49% advantage for the UHD 750, but in this instance, that means that the UHD 750 has a high enough average frame rate to cope with the demands of normal gameplay. The GT 1030's average frame rate is so high in this mode that it has actually created a CPU bottleneck. And you can see that because the 10900K is about the same as the 11600K here when paired with the GPU. We tested Rocket League at 1080p with all settings minimized except for render quality, which controls the render resolution of the game. So that was set to be just 1:1 to allow our resolution to take control. The UHD 750 had a smaller lead here over the UHD 630 than in some other games, down to 20% here. But again, we confirmed that the frame rate wasn't capped and it was capable of rising above 60 FPS under the right circumstances. The GT 1030 with GDDR5 held a 137% advantage over the 11600K's IGP here, although the DDR4 version remains as poorly positioned as ever. We saw this in our review of the DDR4 GT 1030 as well, where we complained primarily that NVIDIA should have renamed its GPU completely with such a drastic change in the performance. We have an abbreviated chart from Minecraft, simply comparing the two IGPs against each other. This is a lightweight workload. It's barely worth benchmarking in any circumstance except for those where we're testing DXR or RTX, or we're testing extremely low-end parts like the IGPs. Minecraft Bedrock Edition has multiple graphics options that aren't serviced in-game, and we also noticed that, with the IGPs, the in-game menu refused to allow increase in the draw distance beyond 16 chunks. Editing it to a higher number in the settings file had no effect either. 16 chunks is a small maximum draw distance for this game, but it was what we were limited to. In this IGP versus IGP comparison, the UHD 750 has an 18% lead at 75 FPS average, similar to the scaling in Rocket League. RTX or DXR effects are sadly not available on the IGPs, so we can't test those for this one. Ultimately, what we've learned here is that if you want to buy the F SKU of an Intel processor, you're not necessarily losing a lot. You obviously better have a GPU in there, a discrete GPU, or you're not going to be able to do anything with it. But you're not losing a lot, except for maybe QuickSync, which we haven't retested here. But those of you who know you need it, should already know that you should get it because it's not that commonly used or deployed. Premiere, there's some advantages. A couple other applications we don't use, but if you're not aware of where you would use Intel QuickSync or whatever they've rebranded it to, then you don't need to worry about it. So the F SKU is fine to try and save a few bucks, but it is really only a few bucks. So now you're sort of arguing over whether losing that troubleshooting capability is worth it. As a stopgap, the real core of this content was to answer that question. As a stopgap, it's okay enough to play something like Fortnite. It really wasn't bad in Fortnite. We didn't have any major stutters that we detected in our real-world play or our benchmarking play, and it seems okay there. You are going to be on low settings, but it can do 1080p, and it's not stuttering in a massive way. CSGO, we benchmarked and played as well, and on the 10900K especially, which we're mentioning because it's a CPU we're sort of recommending right now, it's better than the 11900K in basically every way. The 10900K's IGP is old enough where it's almost nauseating sometimes the type of stutters that are introduced. You can drop the settings further, you drop the resolution, but at some point it's just not enjoyable enough and you're better off doing something else altogether. As for the GT 1030 as a stopgap, that's actually pretty good. It's a maybe a better card than we would normally give it credit for just because of the current market. So shouldn't be buying it for more than 100 bucks. It's not worth that. But at 100 or below, a GT 1030 GDDR5 model is reasonable. It can play pretty much all these games on lower settings, at least the ones we tested today, and you'll be okay. When you get into more AAA territory, Cyberpunk, don't bet on it. And do not buy the DDR4 version of the GT 1030. It's really bad. It's basically a display out only card. It is not suitable for this type of gaming. So that's it for this one. Answering the question, is an IGP good enough for a stopgap, for an in-between solution while you wait for a GPU? It depends on the types of games you play. If they're really low-end games that would typically be branded as quote-unquote esports games, there's a good chance you can play those. Something like Dota 2, Fortnite, stuff like that, you'll be okay on the IGP. As soon as it gets more demanding than that, you're gonna be dropping settings hard. You might drop below 1080p, and it might become unworth it. So that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Subscribe for more. As always, you can go to store.gamersnexus.net or patreon.com/gamersnexus to help us out directly, and I'll see you all next time.